5 years ago, give or take, that there was no ongoing history, and we were gradually losing studios. We have two famous studios that are now parking lots. We'll get into those, what happened there, and why they're now parking lots. We have one that's a new condominium. We can get an apartment for, you know, $2,000 or $3,000 a month overlooking I-65. And I think there might be one more that's a commercial building. But we've lost four historic studios to the name of Progress. And we almost lost RCA Studio A a couple of years ago. Fortunately, an investor bought it, realized the importance of the history of that studio, and saved it from the wrecking ball. Otherwise, RCA A would be a building or a hotel or something, but not a recording studio. Not a studio where Elvis recorded and Dolly recorded and Perry Como recorded. Not a studio where the last two albums of the year by Chris Stapleton have come out of. It's a shame what's happening to the history of the town.
Don't you think some of it has to do with the fact that the board in this city are completely out of touch with these two streets?
Well, they're out of touch with the roots, you know. How many of you guys see Facebook, use Facebook regularly, all the time? Okay, I have a Fred Vail site, I also have a Treasure Isle Recorder site. If you go onto my Treasure Isle site, I just posted a comment last night that's had quite a bit of feedback. And it's about the change from a talent-based industry to a marketing-based industry. Mm-hmm. You know, Elvis, Roy Orbison, Carl Wilson of the Beach Boys, George Jones, and even up through it, including Vince and Dolly, did not need Pro Tools auto-tuning. I've been to sessions with virtually all of them, and I guarantee you, we didn't use vocal tuning. But we have it, you know, and now it's more likely if you get turned down, it's going to be because of your age or your size, one or the other. You know, they're not signing too many size 18 women, they're not signing too many 48-inch waist men. You know, you gotta look good in jeans and a bare midriff and have a little bit of a body, and that will get you signed. Now, granted, there is talent out there. There's some amazing talent out there. But it's not talent-based like it was when Chet Atkins and Charlie Fatch and Don Vaugh and Jim Fogelson and Steve Scholes and Chet Atkins basically gave this town birth in the 1940s, mid-1950s. So that's what this tries to capture. Is the reason why Nashville became Music City USA. And you have a role in that because you're continuing that process. All of you are in some way, shape, or form. The first music business that I'm aware of in Nashville that was strictly music biz was Fred Rose and Roy Acuff's Acuff Rose Publishing out on 8th Avenue, Melrose District, 1946. And the first studio didn't come along until the first studio, dedicated studio, came along in 46, but it only lasted a year or two, and then there was a gap until the mid-1950s when Owen and Harold Bradley started the Quonset Hut. So what we're going to do is we're going to start pre-Nashville. What was going on before Nashville became Music City USA? If any of you here, and I won't ask for a show of hands, are 74 or older, this is the soundtrack of your life. Every one of these records pretty much happened during your lifetime. From the first recorded session that I'm aware of, which was Eddie Arnold, December 4th, 1944, up through 2019. They're all on here. There's a little preamble that I'm going to play for you that goes rather quickly about what it was, you know, where was country music before Nashville became Music City USA. So that's where we'll start. Get up here. Thank you. Okay, let's pause right there. Take a look at country music's first superstar. Any resemblance to Luke Bryan or Jason Aldean is purely coincidental. That is country music's first star. Little Log Cabin on the Range was the first hit. It was recorded in Atlanta around 1923 by fiddler John Carson. And he was a fiddler, You know, he did live gigs. And they recorded him, and the record came out and sold about 40,000 copies, which is not a big amount of records, 78. But it was enough to impress investors in New York City, where Columbia, RCA, RCA Victor, or RCA Bluebird was at the time, Edison Phonograph Company, OK Records, which was a large independent, Brunswick, which was a large independent. So, you know, they decided they would take a gamble on country music, or mountain music, or hillbilly music, as it was often referred to back then, and they decided to record some records. So that's the first one, Little Log Cabin on the Lane, and that was 1923.
They'll
see hard work.
You don't do love
and Vernon Dalhart. Okay, Vernon Dalhart recorded under 100 different names. By nature, he was an opera singer, but he recorded under different dialects and different names. And his record in 1924, The Wreck of the Old 97 and The Prisoner's Song, which was the B-side, became one of the biggest records of the 20th century. By all accounts, between 78 RPM record sales and sheet music, and we'll talk about that in a bit, between the two mediums, Wreck of the Old 97 and Prisoner's Song sold a reported 6 million copies
wow.
in 1924-25. According to the Library of Congress, it could be the largest selling country record of the first half of the 20th century, most likely. It is. That's a lot of records. If you didn't have the attention of investors in Wall Street by now, head started to turn. So that's 1924. Okay. Uncle Jimmy Thompson, first star of Grand Ole Opry, right here in Nashville, Tennessee. And the great Jimmy Rogers, singing Brakeman. Mississippi Blue Yodeler, the first member of the Country Music Hall of Fame, 1961. Okay, then Nashville comes on the scene. December 4th, 1944. No recording studio, so they recorded WSM radio in the radio studio.
It's like heaven and being near you.
Okay, interesting story here. This is Nashville's first number 1 million seller. Francis Craig and his orchestra on a little independent label called Bullet Records. We pass that around, sheet music again. Keep in mind that it's 1946, World War II is over. The airmen and the Navy and the Army guys are returning from Europe or from the Pacific. And they're hooking up with their wives, or their wives soon to be, or they're bringing home, you know, fräuleins from Germany, or, you know, girls from France and marrying them. And they were done with war. They thought they were done with war. They hoped they were done with war. And they only wanted to do one thing. They wanted to spend the rest of their life near you, I mean, with that bride. So Francis Craig and Kermit Gould wrote a song called Near You, 1946. It goes on the radio, number one in Cashbox and Billboard for 17 weeks. Ends up being the biggest song of the year, the number one song of the year on the two trade magazines. Cashbox, which was primarily for jukebox operators, and Billboard, which was for the regular mainstream music industry. So that's where, you know, Near You comes into play. Francis had a orchestra, a society band, and they would play at the Bellevue Country Club, and they would also appear regularly at the Hermitage Hotel down on Church and Sixth. It was a palace by those standards back in the 40s and 50s. The Hermitage was a beautiful hotel. Now it's a Suites Hotel. They redid it about 20 years ago. Beautiful, you know, beautiful hotel. And he had the dance band there. That was his weekly gig, playing at the Hermitage, when he wasn't playing at the Bellevue Country Club. And he was what they call a society band. So this record by Francis and Kermit becomes the number one record of 1946-47, and as such, the first number one record nationally for Nashville. And it's not a country record, it's a pop record. So that gives you something to think about right there. Okay. 1946, three engineers from WSM Radio, they had an office downtown on north of Broadway around 6th or so, near Jefferson, and they decide that Nashville needs a recording studio. Now keep in mind, it's 1946, so it is literally 70 years after Thomas Alva Edison invents the talking machine or the disc player or the Victrola, which evolves into the phonograph. It's 70 years after that, and it's 21 years after the Grand Ole Opry launches in 1925. We were late bloomers when it comes to recording studios. We didn't have our first dedicated studio until 1946, and that was the three engineers from WSM, and they set it up in a section of the ballroom of the Hermitage Hotel. Not the Hermitage Hotel, the Tulane Hotel, I'm sorry, the Tulane Hotel. If you're looking for the Tulane Hotel, it's the parking lot. So that was our first dedicated studio. Some of the artists that recorded there, including the great Hank Williams, the father, not the son, not Junior, and Chet, and Ernest Tubb, and a few other giants of that era recorded at the Castle Recording Company. It was called the Castle Recording Company. About a year, maybe 2 years into the studio scene, the three engineers get a call. They're going to have a meeting with the people at WSM Radio, and they go to the meeting, and the people at WSM say, "Hey, you guys are spending too much time down at your, Castle Recording Company. You're kind of letting your job duties here at WSM sag a little bit. You're reporting in late too often. You're going to have to make a decision. Keep your paycheck, your benefits, close the studio, or you can keep the studio, resign your position, and don't let the door hit you on the way out." What do? They take the paycheck. They close the studio. So that's the Castle Recording Company, which was the first committed recording studio in Nashville in 1946-47. Okay, let's listen a little bit of the great Hank. In the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and the Country Music Hall of Fame. Sunday School Board has a studio over between 15th and 16th on McGavick, a half a block south of Broadway, right by Beeman Toyota, GMC. You've probably been by a bazillion times. Right behind it, there was a studio. It was called the Trapco Studio. And that's where Elvis recorded Heartbreak Hotel, his first worldwide number one record, recorded on January 10th, 1956. Believe it or not, it was his first number one record. He'd been around for 2 years. But previous to that, all the releases on Sam Phillips' Sun record label out of Memphis were deemed to be country, not rock and roll. They were regional hits in many instances. They did not go to top 10 on Billboard or Cashbox. So the first record that comes out on RCA, after Steve Scholes signs him to RCA for a reported $35,000, that record, Park Ridge Hotel, written by Mayborn Axton, White Axton's mom, goes to number one worldwide. And all of a sudden, since Elvis is recording in Nashville, it must be a pretty cool place to be. Maybe we ought to send our artists over to Nashville and, you know, take advantage of some of that Southern hospitality and great players, great musicians, great background singers that are, you know, working over there. And then that starts to see the growth of Nashville as a recording mecca. Interesting to note that the two greatest stars of the first half of the 20th century, the great Hank Williams and the great Jimmy Rogers, the father of country music as we know it, both of them had 6 years. Their careers were cut by death. They died. Jimmy Rogers recorded from 1926 to 1932, died of complications from tuberculosis, recorded in Nashville, recorded the famous Bristol Sessions in Bristol, Tennessee, Virginia, which had taken place in 1927, Ralph Peter, when he comes down to Bristol, Tennessee, and over a period of 5 days, in August, ironically, in August of 1927, Ralph Peer, with some portable equipment, set up in a deserted warehouse, records 72 sides or tracks. And out of those 72 tracks become three future members of the Country Music Hall of Fame. The great Jimmy Rogers, father of country music, Pop Stoneman and the Stoneman Family Band, and the amazing Carter family, A.P., Sarah, and Mother Maybell. They all came out of those 5 days of recording at the Bristol Session. Years later, Johnny Cash, my friend, would say that the Bristol Sessions were the big bang of country music. That's where it blew up. That's where it took off. That's where it became, you know, more leaning toward to eventually become America's music. Was the Bristol Sessions of 1927. So we've got Elvis recording in 56, and then the Quonset Hut. The Bradley brothers, Owen, a keyboard player and arranger, producer, along with his brother, Harold, a guitar player, purchase a house at 34 Music Square East, which is 16th Avenue South back then, for $7,500, and started recording in the home. And they realized at a certain point that they needed a little bit bigger studio, that the house had low ceilings, it was a little bit too confining. So they purchased an old Army Quonset hut, and they put it in the back of the house, and that became their Quonset hut recording studio. So this segment I'm gonna show you now is songs that came out of the Quonset Hut, which was probably the most successful studio, and it, along with RCA Studio B, were two of the most significant studios in the history of Nashville and the growth of the music scene here. So these are all records that came out of the Quonset Hut. Here's the Bradley recording studio. Gene Vincent, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, produced by Ken Nelson. Okay. Take a pause for the cause. Gone, 1956-57, Ferlin Husky. Recorded at the Quonset Hut, Ken Nelson producing. Ken was the head of A&R, country A&R at Capitol Records. And he had replaced Lee Gillette, or been appointed by Lee Gillette to do the country division. And he came into Nashville and was using the Quonset Hut studio primarily. He had cut this same song, Gone, by Ferlin Husky, under the name of Terry Preston. He had done it a couple of years before. It was released on Capitol, didn't meet with a lot of success, but Ken believed in the song. He believed in Terry, changed his name to Ferlin Husky, and who certainly is more memorable than Terry Preston. And they end up going into the studio and recording a song called Gone. Now, keep in mind of the era. This is now 1956, 1957. What is going on that would change Nashville's perception in country music forever? What's going on in 56, 57?
Rock
and roll. All of a sudden, country music is competing with rock and roll for airplay, for shelves at the retailer, for charts, for advertising dollars, for ticket sales. All of a sudden, there's this competition going on between rock and country. So what Ken Nelson does, and he's a genius, he decides that he'll take country music uptown a notch. So he replaces the steel guitars and fiddles with string sections. He replaces the solo background singer with the Jordanaires doing four-part harmony and Melly Kirkham doing the soprano above the four-part harmony. He uses a piano as a primary instrument, acoustic piano, grand piano. And he takes country uptown. And Gone by Ferlin Husky becomes the number one country record on the country charts and a top five record on the pop charts for 1956-57. Ferlin Husky, Gone. Three of the greatest Christmas songs of all time recorded a block from here. Okay, my pet peeve, my soapbox opportunity of the day. Johnny Horton's music, including the Battle of New Orleans, the first country grand in 1960. It was the first country Grammy recorded in Nashville by a Nashville singer, a Nashville label, a Nashville producer, a Nashville studio. The year before, 1958-59, the first country and western, as it was called, the first country and western Grammy, went to what group and what was the song? How many of you music buffs know who won the first country and western Grammy in 1958-59? Any of you know? A hint, they're not country. Number two, it wasn't done in Nashville. Number three, it wasn't a country song. No, you're too soon.
Shed Woolley.
Nope.
The Weavers.
Nope. Jimmy Driftwood, the Kingston Trio, Tom Dooley.
Oh.
You guys remember Tom Dooley? How many of you remember Tom Dooley?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So Kingston Trio, a folk group from San Francisco, on Capitol Records in Los Angeles, recorded a live album called Live at the Hungry Eye, which was a folk club in San Francisco. And Tom Dooley becomes a hit single, and it becomes the Grammy winner for the first year of the Grammy Awards. It covered the year 1958, product released during 58. It was actually in 1959 that they had the first Grammy Award ceremony. So Nashville's not representative of the first country and western Grammy. What is? Johnny Horton, a Jimmy Driftwood song, a folk song called The Battle of New Orleans. Johnny Horton is the most snubbed, unrecognized, uninducted member of the Country Music Hall of Fame. His music has lasted five generations. Not only the Battle of New Orleans, which was the number one country record of 1959-60. A friend of mine, Buzz Bennett, who was a program director, told me in late 1969, we were in a music conference together and we were talking about country music. And he said, do you realize that the Battle of New Orleans by Johnny Horton was the most requested record at radio of the whole decade of the 1950s.
Wow.
10 years. It was the most requested record of reading. And it's still not in the Country Music Hall of Fame. He did Sink the Bismarck. He did North to Alaska, the famous John Wayne movie. He did the title track. All for the Love of Girls, Johnny Gordon. Honky Tonk Man, a hit for George Jones. Dwight Yoakam's first hit on Warner Brothers. He wrote that song. Unfortunately, he was hit by a drunk driver on the way back from a gig in Texas and died in 1961, cutting short his career. And he is still not in the rotunda. He is not in the
Country Music Hall of Fame. Did he?
Who did he piss off?
Right.
Well, I have two answers for that. We've got music executives that don't know about the history of country music, and they could care less about the history of country music. That's number one. Number two, he doesn't have a family to fight for. Billie Jean Horton. Ever heard of Billie Jean Horton?
No.
You could either call her a two-time loser, or you could call her a two-time winner. Billie Jean Horton, at age 19, married the great Hank Williams. He was killed a year later in an automobile accident between here and Danville, Canton, Ohio. She becomes a widow of Hank Williams. Who does she marry next? Johnny Horton. He's killed by a drunk driver. So you either call that a two-time winner or a two-time loser. But I think that because Johnny doesn't have anybody to fight for, it's one of the reasons he's not in the Country Music Hall of Fame.
Fred, did John sing that song about the Indian
Elijah? No, Elijah was Hank Williams. Squaws Along the Yukon?
Running Bear.
Running Bear.
No, that's Billy Preston.
Who was Billy Preston?
Yeah.
Because that was the same time frame, correct?
Yeah, in that era, yeah. Billy Preston passed away not too long ago. I met him once at a gig in Springfield, Tennessee.
I remember when the Battle of New York, that was a big
Massive record.
Massive.
Okay, so there's that. Let's see.
Out in the West Texas.
First,
that's the one.
4 minutes, 57 seconds. I was a DJ then, kid DJ, and I could actually go to the bathroom. My other buddies who were older than me, they'd go out, have a smoke or have a drink on the balcony and come back in, the record would still be playing. But I could go to the John and come back in and the record would still be playing. Most records back in that era, believe it or not, were between 2 and 2.5 minutes long. That was the average length of a record in the 50s.
Exactly.
2 to 2.5 minutes.
Exactly.
This record was 4 minutes and 57 seconds. What was the question? I'm sorry.
I said back to that now.
Yeah. But they have loops now. They didn't have those then.
Excuse me, Fred, I have a question.
Yeah.
This is obviously about country music, but during the same time frame, were the R&B and the great black artists like Chuck Berry and others, were they coming out of Memphis at the same time?
Well, they were coming out of Cincinnati. Uh-huh. They were coming out of New Orleans. They were coming out of Memphis.
Yep. Did Sam Phillips ever
Sam
record?
Was out of Memphis.
Did Sam record any of the great black artists?
Yeah. He did Little Melton, and he did a couple of
others. King?
No, yeah, he had black artists. Okay, so here's Marty. Changed my life forever. Elvis was in the Army. The teen idol was Ricky Nelson, The Adventures of Ozzy and Harry. How many of you remember that show and Ricky? Okay. At the grand old age of 12 years old, I interviewed Ricky Nelson on the set of Ozzy and Harriet for my elementary school newspapers. So that was one event. The second event, a friend of mine was a DJ on a top 40 station, Kerry K Radio, and he invited me down to help him with his show and cue records up and answer the request line and go pull a copy off the Associated Press, the United Press International teletype, and bring it into him and circle the weather report and circle, you know, the news of the day, the headlines of the day. One Saturday, he said, go get the Sacramento Union, the morning newspaper. He said, open it up to the sports page, and I'm going to open up the mic. I want you to give the audience the sports scores from last night's Friday night high school games. So he did, and so at the ripe old age of 12, I became a team news announcer on the radio. At 15, I became an announcer at a jazz station, because I couldn't talk myself onto a rock and roll station, and there was no country station. And then between my junior and senior year, at the ripe old age of 17, I became a DJ and program director of a country music FM station, KCNW. So that was the second thing that changed my life. The third thing, and perhaps the most influential thing, in 1957, there were only a handful of country music radio stations, less than 80 at the time, throughout the United States. Less than 80 country stations in the entire United States. Most were in the South. Many of them were what's called a daytimer, signed on at sunrise, signed off the air at sundown. A lot of them were in small communities, not large metropolitan areas. And if you were to hear a country record had to be big enough to where the pop program directors would cross it over from the country format to the pop format. So it was very few and far between. You know, Battle of New Orleans was one that crossed over, obviously. Marty Robbins, El Paso, crossed over, obviously. You know, there were some records that crossed over, including one by this gentleman. And my brother was a huge country music fan. Now, he's 3 years older than me, so he's 15. And in high school, when everybody is into rock and roll and Elvis and Ricky Nelson, my brother's in the country, and believe it or not, bluegrass music at age 15. So he's turning me on to country artists and bluegrass artists like, you know, the great Mack Wiseman and Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs and Don Greeno and Red Smiley and all these great artists. And he had no interest in rock and roll. So I'm in my bedroom with my Victrola playing rock and roll. My brother's in his bedroom next door with his bluegrass and country, and we're fighting the volume. I'll turn mine up a little bit, and then he'll turn up his a little bit. So my dad would come in and unplug the two phonographs, and that was the end of that little argument. But he said, listen, this weekend there's going to be an act down at this night, what do you want to call it, a ballroom down in South Sacramento. Not to get mom and dad to take us down there. It's in the afternoon. It's on a weekend. And so my mom and dad drive my brother Morgan and I and my friend Bob Jones down to this old World War II ballroom called the New Coconut Grove Ballroom. And it was literally a ballroom. And it was upstairs on the second floor above a laundromat and a drugstore. And we walked up the stairs, and it was on Franklin and Fruitridge, the south side of America. And we walked up the stairs, and at the left of the stairs at the top was a little ticket window. And it was about $50 to get in, so we paid $1.50 and got in. And we went into this ballroom. Now, you got to remember, ballrooms are just that. They're there for dancing. You know, there's no fixed seating. There's a few folding chairs and a few sofas around the perimeter, little chairs. So if you want to sit down, have a cigarette or a Coke or a beer with your girlfriend, you know, you've got a place to sit. But everybody's on the dance floor. It's a dancing hall. The New Coconut Grove Ballroom. So my brother and Bob and I run down to the stage, and we park ourselves at the stage. And I remember standing there, and I've got my elbows on the stage, and I'm looking up, and the curtain opens up, and there's these three guys in red blazers. And the guy on the left is playing an acoustic bass, a slap bass. That was the rhythm, because there's no drummer. So he's playing this acoustic bass. And the guy on the right is playing a Fender Jaguar through a little Fender amplifier down by his feet. And the guy in the middle has a big acoustic guitar, they call it a Tennessee flat top box. And one microphone, no drummer, no background singers. The guy on the stage that introduced me to country music 60 plus years ago was Johnny Cash and the Tennessee Two. Luther Perkins, Marshall Grant, and the great Johnny Cash. That was my introduction to country music for a buck and a half, 63 years ago, okay? So now let's fast forward to 1982, 25 years later, at my studio in Berryville, Treasure Island. The first artist to come in and do an album with Marty Stewart producing is Johnny Cash, ManInBlack.com, a member of the Country Music Hall of Fame. So I go from being a kid fan, meeting him backstage and having him sign his first Sun single, Give My Love to Rose and Cry, 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 to the great Man in Black recording in my little old studio in Berryville. You don't get much better than that.
Fred, what struck you the first time you heard him? What was it about him?
When I heard Cash live?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I mean, Marshall, his bass, which basically was the bass and the drums at the same time, the percussion, and Luther, and that freight train beat that he got going. I mean, that was the original Johnny Cash. You know, that was the Rock Island Line, the Folsom Prison Blues, Give My Love to Rose, Cry, Cry, Cry. I mean, Ballad of a Teenage Queen, which had crossed the pop. The great cowboy song, Yes, Things Happen That Way, Cowboy Jack Lemmon I'm referring to. That was the original Cash. And it was just something about the music and the beat and the simplicity. Very, very sparse background singer. You know, he really didn't need that much. The music and the song spoke for itself.
But yeah, that's like, you know, that's, to me, you know, he just sounded so unique, and some of these artists you're talking about, a lot of them have a really, really unique sound, and when the market wasn't flooded with all kinds of people trying to sound like everybody else, then they would obviously really shine. And so I think, you know, you were talking about tuning earlier, you know, auto-tuning, and you know, like a Johnny Cash obviously didn't have that,
right,
have that tool to use if you wanted to use it, but just the authenticity, even if he sang a flat note or something.
Yeah, it was authentic is a good word for it. Spontaneous is a good word for it. You know, I mean, I'll get to it when I get into this next segment, so coming up in a minute, but put that thought on.
Okay.
Now, so anyway, so this is Cash. And next, the great Patsy Cline.
Stop loving her today. It plays no
huge year in country music. Anybody know what happened that year besides George Jones' He Stopped Loving Her Today? Two other major events happened in country music that helped transform it. Do you know what those two events are? 1980.
Jimmy
Cohen moved here. No. That's not the right time, though.
No, it was, because the, you know, everybody, kind of records before 1980 are members of a little organization we could get in West Carolina.
Well, he,
the original Nashville Sound.
He, he left his mark on Nashville, that's for darn sure.
Who started the original Nashville Sound?
Charlie.
Who did?
Charlie
McCoy. The A-team, the guys that were here between 57 and 63. You know, that's you know, the, I mean, there are others, obviously. Ken Nelson had a lot to do with it. Don Law had a lot to do with it. Chad had a lot to do with it. I mean, you know, I mean, the credit is ample. I mean, there's a lot of people that deserve it. But certainly the Nashville A-team and the Needed First Singers and the Nashville Edition and Jordan Nairs and the local groups had a lot to do with it. The number system had a lot to do with it. The fact that... here's one of the reasons why Nashville became a recording center. The AFM, back at the turn of the century, the AFM is over 100 years old. I think it started in 1911, if I recall. But in all the other jurisdictions, New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Dallas, Texas, I don't know why you're doing that, but it's convenient here in the mail. You had to be able to read music to join the Musicians Union. That was one of the rules. The laws. And Nashville decided that a lot of these guys were self-trained and did it by ear, that they wouldn't require union musicians, Local 257, to have to read music. They didn't have to read music. So that attracted a lot of people. And there's still 18 guys that can't read music. The number system, you know, Gordon Stoker's number system, you know, changed all that. And it's like a musician shorthand. No, the two events that besides George Jones, He Stopped Loving Her Today, to change, you know, country music in 1980, two major events. One, a biopic of Loretta Lynn, coal miner's daughter, Sissy Spacek, wins Oscar for Best Female Performance. And that's one event. And the other event that got all the guys to trade in their cars for pickups and their baseball caps for cowboy hats, and that was Urban Cowboy, John Travolta. Both those movies, you know, came out in 1980 along with You Stop Loving Her Today. So that really revolutionized country, those three events. Elvis recording Little Sister at Studio B, and he starts cracking up and laughing.
Is it working?
And he can't keep his mind on the song, and they did about seven or eight takes before he got it. But that was unusual. It's usually two.
It appears to be.
And also, they would mix it as it's going down, right? So if there was a mistake, there were only two options. Either do it again, take two, or if it could be fixed, the engineer, Bill Porter, or some of the other great engineers of that period, would do what they call a razor edit. They would cut the mistake out of the quarter-inch tape, and they would put a fresh piece of tape over the recording head, and they would have the musicians or the singer or the background singer fix their part. And then they would splice the two ends together, and that would be the finished tape. And of course, I'm listening to music on a little Japanese transistor radio 2,400 miles from here in Sacramento, and there's so much echo and reverb, I can't hear the click. You know, I mean, they were that good at it. I mean, it was flawless, it was seamless. So they were, you know, so that's how they did it back then. And those records were great. I mean, they stand the test of time. All these records that you've heard up till now are basically two-track recordings. Now we're going to get into 4/16, 24-track. We're going to get into digital as this continues. But the ones you've heard up to now have been pretty much two and four-track.
We've got about 15 minutes here.
Okay.
I can get over it.
Set me free. First of all, on record, Don Dixon, "Oh Lonesome Me."
Oh, Lonesome Me.
The flip side of that record was "I Can't Stop Loving You," Don Dixon. So a record had about an eight-week life back then. Come out, they'd release it, it would go up the charts, it would peak, it would drop down like a blood anchor, and if you didn't have another record out by the time the first record had peaked, they would often flip the record over and start playing the B-side. So they flipped over "Oh Lonesome Me," a song called Stop Loving You's on the B side. It goes into the top 10. 4 years later, the great Ray Charles records it, comes out on the ABC Paramount label, and it becomes the Grammy R&B Record of the Year, 1962. I Can't Stop Loving. The great Everly Brothers. First record to go number one pop, number one country, number one R&B. First one in there. Albert Jolly. Studio B, right here. Great Vail and Jennings, the Outlaw Sound, born at RCA. Sonic Lodge, more in Nashville. Fred Foster Recording Company. Before his studio on 17th. Well, this is all RCAB. She can include herself in that list. She won't, but she could. Okay, here's the famous American trilogy, Mickey Newberry, that Elvis closed all of his live concerts with until the end.